Yay!
We are live, and I'll wait for a couple people to maybe actually view it, and then I'll get started.
It's happening.
But I will get started, and good evening. My name is David Quick. I'm the Adult Services Coordinator at DC Public Library, and I'm very happy to welcome people tonight to our final event of our Summer Challenge programming. Summer Challenge is DC Public Library's summer reading program, which we all remember from our youth, reading books and getting pizzas and prizes and things like that. And we still do that. And we're happy to have events, not just for young people, but for adults as well. And I'm very happy to have this event focus on Kat Chow, who we know from radio and podcasting and is local. Our DCPL's own Melinda McCall is in a book club that Kat is part of. And Melinda, thank you for putting us all together to talk about Kat's new book and hear her talk about it.
And thank you also for letting me do this, Melinda, even though I never come to book club.
Melinda,
true confessions of book club.
Yeah, don't book club.
But I'm also very happy that we have our good friend Hannah Oliver Depp of Loyalty Bookstore here to lead the conversation tonight. Loyalty is a great friend of the library, and we're so glad for any opportunity to do things together. And with that, Hannah, I'm going to hand it over to you to lead the rest of the conversation. Last bit of housekeeping, if you're watching tonight and you want to share a thought or a question, hop in the comments either on Facebook or YouTube or even on Twitter. We're streaming to Twitter tonight, and we'll do our best to include the questions. Hannah, it's to you. Thanks so much. Have fun.
Thanks, David.
Woo.
Hi, Kat.
Hi.
Hello from like half a mile away.
I know, hello from very close. I'd like everyone to know that it's Hannah's birthday today, and I cannot believe Hannah's moderating this because, I don't know, on my birthday, I think I'd just be like, I want to go drink champagne. So I really appreciate that. Thank you very much.
In true chaotic August Virgo form, I'm like, it's performing with the tinge of Leo left over in the air, plus checking something off a checklist to really just touch my Virgo heart. No, I am utterly delighted to be talking to you on my birthday. It's a great thing to do on my birthday. I think you're underestimating how fabulous you are, Kat.
Well, thank you, friend.
We're talking about Seeing Ghosts today, Kat Chow's fantastic memoir. There are so many memoirs and there are a lot of memoirs that come out, and I've started to try to find something else to call them, even though this is absolutely a memoir, because I feel like there might be a little bit too many. Right now, it's like a very popular genre, which is very cool, but also on the other hand, it's like, I think, watered down. This is such a powerful meditation on so many different things. And it also made me laugh a lot. I was talking with another bookseller on Twitter, and we were like, you know that like thing where you're laughing, but you're also crying, and you just got like snot and tears and laughter happening all at the same time? That's what was happening with this book. And so I'm really, really psyched to talk to you about it today. But do you want to kick us off with a little reading?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And before I start, I just wanted to say also thank you to the DC Public Library for inviting me to be a part of this. I basically grew up in libraries with my family. We would go there to use the free air conditioning, because even though we had air conditioning in Connecticut, we never turned it on for some reason. But in honor of the massive thunderstorms that we had today, I will be reading a very short chapter in Seeing Ghosts that's based on a thunderstorm. And it's addressed to my mom, who is, you know, a subject that I write toward frequently in this book.
Mm.
When power cut during thunderstorms, you untangled yourself from my arms to play hide and seek in the darkened rooms of our house. Come and find me, you said to my sisters and me during every storm. You raced from the room to hide. No, we wailed and reached for your legs. Come and find me, you repeated. Your voice faded into the walls. We fumbled as we waded through the humidity that dampened the house. We crept into the living room where we suspected you waited and rubbed our dirty toes into the short fringe of the carpet. We took in the profiles of the potted fern and jade plants illuminated by the gray light from the window. Behind those would be a good hiding spot, we whispered to one another. Thunder rattled the house Then lightning split the sky with a shock of yellow. We whimpered. "Where are you?" we said to the plants. We parted the fern fronds. There were only inky outlines of more leaves. "Where are you?" we said again, our voices unsteady. Then a giggle rose from behind the couch. It flickered, your laughter striking an entire matchbook. You sprang from where you had crouched this entire time. "I'm here," you bellowed. We screamed and giggled while we scattered in search of our own hiding spots. "Come and find us," we yelled while we tucked ourselves behind doors and underneath beds. "I will," you shouted. "I'm coming to find you." In high school, after you are dead, I think of those hide-and-seek games as I walk past the living room and up the stairs. I imagine taxidermic you, stuffed and stitched and posed in a kneeling position behind the couch. I worry that if the light shifts, if I look too closely, I will see your face in the shadows. Jesus Christ, Mommy. Thank you. Oh no, Hannah, I think you're on mute. I think Hannah disappeared, but I can do a little bit and share about where this chapter came from. It was, you know, really trying to play off of my mom's sense of humor. And she had a very macabre sense of humor, as you might glean from that passage. I'm just describing where that came from, and I was talking about my mom's sense of
humor. Your mom's sense of humor, yeah.
Very macabre.
Though the storm is over now in DC, apparently my internet has decided it is it's scared of being haunted by this book. No, so your mom's sense of humor, I actually, like, we're right. That's exactly where I wanted to go to, because first of all, I love it. And it does sort of remind me of my mother. I think people who are trapped between cultures a lot of times, sense of humor is really, really important to, like, your own mental stability and survival, and then also how you bond with your kids. And so I think, like, you and your family have a really incredible sense of humor throughout the book and a lot of inside jokes, but also sometimes there's, like, it's almost also used as, like, a blockade for real communication sometimes when you don't want to talk about things.
It totally is. I mean, even now, I think my default is to laugh when I'm uncomfortable or to make a really deadpan joke. And I think that was something that I learned from my parents in a lot of ways, or at least specifically my mom. Mm-hmm. And we've always been a family of a very dry humor and a dry sensibility like that. And it really just, it was one of the ways that I wanted to craft this book. I mean, I don't, you know, I was once trying to describe this book to a friend who had just read a very early draft a year and a half ago. Mm-hmm. And after she read it, she gave me feedback, and I asked her if she thought it was funny, and she paused and was like, I wouldn't call it, you know, it's like, it's a lot about some sad stuff. And so I'm really glad that the humor and the subtleness of that is stuff that people seem to be picking up on. But yeah, it really seeded one of the jokes that my mom made, which helped craft the narrative of this book, which was about taxidermy. Because mm-hmm. I'd always been afraid of dead things and taxidermy as a kid. We'd go to the L.L. Bean store in Maine on camping trips, and I would be so afraid of, you know, this giant moose. I don't know if you ever went there as a kid.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah,
terrifying. Yeah. Yeah.
And, you're like, I'm sorry. That's very large. And also it's dead. And we're just all, I think, yeah, like, that's normal.
And we're okay with it. Okay. That's cool. That's cool. But I really had this fear of dead things because I think I, as a child, couldn't understand or really make sense of why people would want to memorialize something dead. Mm-hmm. And my mom knew this and would constantly joke about it. And one day she made a joke about how when she eventually died, she wanted to be stuffed and put in my future apartment, mm-hmm. which I was 9 years old. And that's you know, not the most comforting image, but it really stuck with me. And in a way, you know, as a writer, I've always been drawn to that. And I will let the reader decide if that's, you know, metaphor, if I'm really seeing ghosts in my life. That's something fun for readers to figure out. But I also loved that it fit really well with this concept in a lot of East Asian culture, which is ancestor veneration. which is in my family, there were just a lot of, you know, sayings like, if you don't appease the spirit of XYZ person, then they're going to be restless. And right. that really kind of merged to make me, in a way, fear this idea of my mom as this ghost taxidermic thing.
Yeah, the idea, you don't say zombie in the book, very much so. It's not a concept, but there's like the spirit, the idea of the spirit haunting, and then there's like an actual physical creature in your house. And like, you weren't scared that your mother was going to be a taxidermy creature. Well, I can't say you weren't. It's not like in the book that you were like, and then it would come alive and scream at me or yell at me or express disappointment or something. But there is, there's the concept of like a friendly, welcoming haunting that your ancestors can do for you, of like just being so present with you. And then there's the concept of never being able to move on. And like, what does moving on look like when it's your mother?
Right, right. That's a really good distinction. And I think I wanted to sort of sit in that in-between space because that actually leads me to an interesting thought, which is I don't really consider this book a grief memoir.
Yeah.
And that's something that my agent and I would talk about frequently, mm-hmm. where I think a lot of grief memoirs follow this trajectory where, you know, usually there's a death that occurs toward the end of the book. And mm-hmm. a lot of that story is sort of in sometimes like reverse chronological order, or just showing the year after the fallout of that death. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. so it's a very tight timeline, but I wanted mm-hmm. to show how loss can be embedded over the years and really become someone's identity.
Yeah. Let's dig into that a little bit too, because first of all, we have a general horror, I think, very much so mistakenly, of being marked by grief. We're like, we don't want to be marked by death. We don't want to be associated with death. And kind of refusing to acknowledge that we all are, first of all. And also what it actually means to live with that and have it be a present part of your life. And I think people's imagination is that you just walk around crying 24 hours a day. But you literally grow up in this book because it happens to you so young. And so, but again, it's a part of your whole life. So I want you to talk a little bit about that, because it isn't a grief memoir. It's not about like leading up to this really sad moment. And then you picked yourself up and moved on, and there was a dove, and like, you know, it's absolutely not that book. So I do want you to talk a little bit about the distance that you cover in this book, and what it's like to have this be a part of you.
Yeah, I really wanted to show the way loss manifests in specifically an immigrant family, mm-hmm. where I think I noticed as a kid, I was pretty in tune to the ways it seemed like my family had to inhabit these negative spaces. Mm-hmm. Where I grew up in a very suburban town in Connecticut that the demographics were what you might expect, pretty white. You know, I mean, not all white, obviously, but we didn't really have a community that looked like us besides my mom's family. Mm-hmm. And so after she passed, it was just sort of on my dad and me to make our own. And within that, I just always understood that there was this sense of loss, and I couldn't really pinpoint what it was. And so as a journalist now, and as an adult trying to look back on how to tease out all those, you know, like mirrors and parallels between my parents, one of the ways that I did it was by trying to look at the ways in which we learned to grieve and how those losses can really shape you over time. Yeah.
Yeah. It's learning to grieve while you're also learning to read and write and ride. You know what I mean?
And be like, a person.
Yeah. And be a person. Because you're so young when you lose your mom, and, you know, it's almost like you go through life and, you know, you say like, if this comes up, you have to deal with the people being like, oh, I'm so sorry. You know, and that kind of thing. And you're already living in a world which, depending on the group of people you're with, is the unspokenness of your Asianness, right? Like people are like, oh, you know, that we're not going to say why you're different, but you're different.
Yeah. That was something I always knew. I mean, it's not, I think I was lucky in that I had two older sisters. So I was never, you know, ashamed of being the daughter of Chinese immigrants. I always had them to look up to, and, you know, we were just indisputably Chinese. We, you know, we don't look white, can't pass as white. And so I think I always had that going for me, but I think the thing that you and I are sort of approaching talking about is this concept of melancholia, which I felt so innately, and I did not have the vocabulary for that for so many years. And it's like a, you know, it's a Sigmund Freud term where he makes the distinction between mourning and melancholia that a bunch of Asian American scholars have sort of picked up on and attached racial melancholia to it, which is as immigrants or as people of color, you don't just lose, you know, an object or a person or a place, but you sort of lose this sense of self that's so tied to, you know, your racial upbringing or your culture.
Yeah, that you've lost a tether. You've lost a tether. Yeah, yeah. There is that sense. And so as you go through like going to college, figuring out what you want to do with your life, and it's like there's so many ideas that you say where it's like it's hunting or it's a shadow or something, and you're like, that doesn't express that it's inside of you as opposed to something external. And I think that's what the book does so beautifully, because I felt it completely while in this book, and yet when you're outside of the book, and I'm trying to tell people, I'm like, you need to read this book.
Thank you.
And they're like, it's just like about death for that many pages.
And like taxidermy.
And you're like, yeah, and some taxidermy and also journalism. And but I do think that you really managed to, in the writing, sit us in that space and not let us get uncomfortable and leave. You made us laugh in that space. You made us cry in that space. You made us thoughtful in that space. You made me think about my own spirit and the way that my family carries through my body. Mm. But you don't ever leave us in that space. Was that like a hard writing challenge for you? Like, because you lived with this a lot longer than I did reading it.
I did live with this for a really long time.
Yeah.
And if my editor is in on this call, she should type in the comments so I know what to say or not say. I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
I mean, it was, I really, for the most part, enjoyed working on this book, because not that I thought it was like a joyful experience all the time. It was very hard. And it took many.
It's a complicated word though.
Yeah.
Joy is a complicated word.
It is. I think I felt as though I really kind of came into my own, and writing it felt as though I had, one, been able to kind of reclaim a voice that I had been struggling to hold on to as a journalist, where I felt like this book was just indisputably mine. And I could write without explanation if I wanted to. I could refuse to translate any of the Cantonese. I could, you know, make any distinctions I wanted to or not. And it was really awesome to have that power. But what was really a gift for me, I think, was being able to create this lens of, you know, I have all these jokes about taxidermy. I've created all these shorthands of the faces that my family makes, or just thematic resonances. And to be able to kind of just wink to them really quickly, while also then writing about this guy named Young Wing, who was the first Chinese American man to graduate from Yale in like the 1800s. That was really an incredible thing. Mm-hmm. And I felt like I was just kind of building this space that I could sit in for a while. And that was really nice.
No, I really do feel like it's, I think one of the, again, when I was like, it's a memoir, but it's not a memoir in that it's somebody like, and then I had toast for breakfast, you know, and like, it's a memoir because it puts me inside of your universe. I'm completely inside of your world. And then when you do reference other historical events, or you're doing research, or you're sharing, I learned a lot of things in this book. It still all fits into your universe, right? Like, just like if someone were to come in my universe, I tell them a bunch of weird facts about medieval armor, and they'd be like, why is this black lady? Like, why is this part of her universe, right? If I were to paint you a whole picture of everything about my world, it's going to go in some directions.
Yeah.
Because like, that's people. That's a full person. And this is the story of like fully becoming a person. And I think it's just a really enjoyable space to be in. But I want to talk a little bit about where you do go in the book, that when you do go around to places outside of your like direct narrative, and what it was like to research that and how you ended up with what you ended up with. I don't want to give away like everything that's in the book, but
you can just give the cliff
notes. Like, and on page 27, no. But we end up in several places over the world, both because you both travel, but also like the topics that come up in the book. How was researching that, and like, what did you have to leave out? What did you get to keep in that you were excited about keeping? How much do you know about taxidermy now? Are there other like stories of famous people that you wanted to include, or not famous people that should be famous?
Yeah, wanted to include? Yeah. This is a really good question. I think so. One of the most unwieldy drafts that I submitted to my editor was probably like 110,000 words. And the book as it's published now, I think is probably closer to 85 or something like that.
Yeah,
and it had footnotes. The footnotes version, I was a little sad to see go, but I'm actually really happy that it does not have footnotes like that.
There's a director's cut somewhere with footnotes.
No, I think I'm going to burn that in a trash can. I just let my curiosities go, and my process in general in reporting is just sort of just dump everything on the page and put everything that I find sort of interesting. And then in drafts 3 or 4 or whatever, I slowly pare it back. But what really helped the guiding force for this book essentially was a few questions that a mentor actually helped me come up with. Keith Woods, he's an editor and, you know, he works at NPR, and it sort of was like this longtime figure in my life who really would be one of the people who would talk to me about narrative writing before I even sold this book. And he was reading just a couple early chapters of what would become Seeing Ghosts. And he asked me what the driving question was that was propelling this. Okay. And I didn't really know, but he told me thematically that everything he noticed that I was so drawn to, whether I was talking about it to him or writing about it, was this idea of what do we owe? And so what do we owe ourselves? What do we owe our families? Because filial duty is such a big concept in Chinese culture. Mm-hmm. What do we owe our ancestors, and what do we owe our cultures? But also what do we owe our senses of home and our bodies? And so as long as anything fit into those very broad questions, I was like, cool, game. That's gonna go in the book. And then awesome. I would pare it back. Yeah.
Request to see the footnotes. It's my birthday. You have to do it.
Someday I'll show it to you.
Awesome. I love footnotes. But also, I mean, the question of what do we owe, you have such an awesome relationship with your family, but also at times a very tense one, because that's what family is. I loved seeing that not everything was perfect, but also that wasn't really the point, right? Like, the perfection or not perfection of your relationship with your family is not the point of this book at all.
Right.
But I felt really included in your family too.
Thank you. I mean, I think what I was aiming for when I was writing about my mom or dad or my sisters or aunts or uncles was trying to write to understand and trying to demonstrate that within the arc of the book, so that the whole narrative, and I think the voice that I tried to channel, is one of uncertainty, where I tried to embrace that, where I can ask my sisters or my dad 1,000 questions about the circumstances of my, for example, my brother's death. I had a brother who died a few hours after he was born. And when I first started working on this section of the book, nobody in my family could seem to agree on basic things of when he was buried or when he died. And I found, or what he died of. And I found that really fascinating, how memory can kind of lock you out.
Yeah, lock you out. And there's so much, maybe still not enough, but there's so much about the stories we tell ourselves, but there's a lot in here about the stories we don't tell ourselves and what we don't focus on and what we don't think about and like what happens in that vacuum, what comes in instead in that vacuum, what appears.
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially when you're a family and you all have some level of the memory, but as long as you don't talk about it, then you each get further and further apart, I think.
Totally. And I think for a long time, my mother felt sort of like she was a bad word. And, you know, invoking her or saying her name or even saying a good memory of her, something simple like, oh, didn't you love when she used to do this? It would be so tremendously painful, right? Because you're talking about someone and you're invoking something good that you'll no longer have access to. Mm-hmm. And I think for many years, that was really hurtful for my family. And it took, in a way, I mean, I don't love saying that writing memoir is cathartic or healing, and I actually don't, I don't think it is. But it was really helpful to have to assemble these anecdotes and really sit down and think of all of the little things that make a person. You know, mm-hmm. the fact that she would wear a Garfield t-shirt, the fact that she would pull a lot of pranks on us, the faces she would make, how her hair was so wavy, kind of like mm-hmm. Sandra Oh, you know, just stuff like that, that I found really nice to kind of bring my mom to life that way.
Yeah, yeah. And it's also very interesting because she's an incredibly lively character, but mm-hmm. we're introduced to her as someone who is already gone.
Right.
And so she's so alive in the pages. And yet we know that obviously that's the driving force of this narrative, is like we're weaving in and out of this while honestly, I don't think that I've seen a lot of books like this that don't feel some sort of pressure to tie up those loose ends or to make it all neat. Because it's not neat. And you didn't come to some penultimate conclusion. There's certainly some questions or answers and some questions are not, but it's actually more about the questions themselves. And I was wondering if there was sort of pressure to get things tighter as far as like a conclusion. I don't want to give away the ending, as it were, but it's not really like a plot ending so much.
That's an interesting question. I never thought of it that way. I mean, I think that, and I don't think this gives too much away, but a lot of what this book is seeking to do is finding the parallels between, as I was saying before, like I'm trying to understand how my parents learned to grieve. And so to do mm-hmm. that, I would find the parallels between my mother and me and the ways in which, you know, her circumstances of being born and her mother dying young and my father just having these absences, but also having this kind of debt that he owed to his mother, which was to find his father's remains. Some backstory, so this gets less confusing to people who are listening. My grandfather, sometime in the 1920s or 1930s, no one really knows, left China to go to Havana, Cuba, to work in restaurants there. And this was not uncommon because America did not allow Chinese immigrants because of the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882. And so often a lot of people from Southern China would go to other places to send remittances home. And my grandfather was one of those people. And there was this big question because my grandfather wound up, you know, basically dying in Cuba and my father never knew him. Mm-hmm. And so the idea of this unknown father figure and a search for one's remains, there were so many resonances like that throughout the book. And so I kind of knew that there would be this implicit structure where I think if you read the book, and now I don't want to give too much away, but hopefully you will feel that there's something kind of pulling you toward the end, in especially the fourth section.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a mystery to be solved, sort of.
Yes. Yes.
And that certainly was compelling. And then also, again, we have these family stories and these overlapping stories, and you pile a couple losses up on each other, and then there's some sort of things that disappear, and then you have some taxidermy to fill the gap.
Yeah, taxidermy is such a good metaphor for grief.
It really is. I mean, please talk more about that, because there's a lot. I mean, some of the humor specifically comes from the taxidermy.
Yeah, I mean, I think taxidermy is so beautiful. And I mean, I'm still afraid of it. My editor made a joke, or I can't tell if she was joking or serious, but she said,
is there about to be like a giant taxidermy animal?
I know, she said she may or may not have sent me something that might have taxidermic vibes, which I'm very, we'll see how I feel about it. But I just kind of love the concept of it, because there's something so interesting about trying to recreate something that is dead. And really, you know, to taxidermy a fish, you are taking it apart, you're pulling off its skin. Not to be really graphic, but I did watch a lot of YouTube videos and read a ton of books about like the cultural history of taxidermy, which Amazing. Is really fascinating. But what I was drawn to is how in a way, a lot of taxidermy artists are trying to give the animal this sort of ineffable quality, which is life. Mm-hmm. And this book resurfaces, or this theme resurfaces in this book, because my father tries to taxidermy a fish himself. And it becomes this kind of metaphor of grief and longing and his inability to let go of certain things. But also, in a way, it becomes a memorial to him too. Mm-hmm. And it's just this shrine sort of sitting in his basement. And I kind of love that idea of taxidermy as this marker and this memorial to the dead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, we should talk about the cover a little bit, actually, because we have a taxidermy fish situation happening. The cover, I think the cover expresses it because it's a little effed up, but it's also very funny, and it's got a little bit of whimsy to it, and it is a little bit haunting. I personally love it. I hope you love your cover too. I think you do. And
I do. I wanted it to be sort of cheeky.
Yeah.
I wanted it to kind of mimic the tone of the book.
Absolutely. What I want to talk a little bit about publishing, because it's always strange to talk about publishing. You know, your relationship with your editor seems like it's been a good one. And you've talked a little bit about your agent too, but I just think that there's a lot, you know, my bookstore exists in order to counterweight a lack of representation in publishing. I think mm-hmm. that this book is such an authentic narrative of a family and your family's connection to your culture and the multiple cultures that you straddle. And I'm very happy that we're able to give more attention to that and that TCPL is giving attention to that. But I think like it is a lot to navigate a very white publishing culture too. So yeah. I wondered if you wanted to talk about that, because you're also a journalist and you've also worked at NPR for years. And you know, we both work in these spaces that like aren't necessarily made for us, but now we're carving our way through them.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I covered race and culture for NPR. And I think that one, having that lens as a journalist who, you know, is able to take a really meta step back, or a step back and take this meta look at my surroundings, that in a way has protected me. Maybe that's a bit of distancing, I don't know. But I think by the time that I started working on this book and entered the publishing field, I was pretty confident in my ability to, one, know the ways in which I wanted to tell the story and what things that I just would not sacrifice in the text. You know, I mean, there's just like a certain style of writing about being the daughter of immigrants that I gravitated toward. And it was as little explanation about Chinese culture as possible.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's not as simple as distilling it to that. But I was pretty fortunate in that my editor, Maddie Caldwell from Grand Central Publishing. She just completely got it and was such a big advocate for this and, you know, never pushed me in the direction of more explanation. It was always, you know, people can figure things out from context clues. The Cantonese, I know I keep talking about the Cantonese.
And I do want to talk about that, so please do. Yeah.
I think nowadays it's kind of like a baseline, right? You don't, or at least I don't need to see, and I think a lot of readers maybe don't need to see a foreign language italicized or made to look different than the English. Mm-hmm. And because in general, my ability to speak the language was such, or my inability to speak it was so, you know, such a big part of how I told the story and the disconnect and just being able to talk to people. It was also, I kind of felt okay about not translating certain things and letting non-Cantonese speakers, you know, figure it out themselves.
Yeah, absolutely.
But, yeah. All this to say, I mean, yeah, publishing is very white, undeniable. But I think I felt pretty fortunate that for the most part, I was either equipped to push back, and I think I'm pretty solid in my ability to do that at this point in my career, which is a product of having done it quite a bunch. But yeah, I think that I knew the direction that this book needed to go in, and having that mapped out made it pretty easy to follow that.
Mm-hmm. So some allies in your corner as well, yes, as your ability to understand. Yeah, you're like, I know what this is going to be, so it's either going to be that or it's not going to be. There's actually a question from Twitter that overlaps with this language as well. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I feel like some cultures don't have the words or have different words to express certain memories and feelings. So being able to discuss and talk about the same things look differently in different languages. And of course, there is a lot about you speaking Cantonese or not speaking Cantonese, yeah, or talking with relatives. Mm-hmm. And their question is, do you explore language barrier as a way of communicating emotions in the book? Which you definitely do, but I wonder if you want to talk a little bit directly to that.
Yes, I do. I do it in a few different places. And the two that I'm thinking, or one of the ones that I'm thinking about is one of the hardest chapters for me to write, which was about my mom's sickness and then eventually her death. And there's a moment where I'm a young child and observing my mom and her sister and her brother kind of talk about her terminal illness, which mm-hmm. was cancer, and it was very sudden. And they're speaking in Cantonese, and as a child, I have no vocabulary and I can't really understand the fear that she has. And as a writer and as an adult reflecting on this, that was really painful to realize and sort of reconcile with, not being able to recreate the language of your own mother. And I try to write about that in the book, where I'm trying to guess with my toddler level Cantonese what words she might have used for herself, when really they were probably words that she taught me to apply to myself when I had like a stomach ache or, you know, something of that nature, the way you would talk to a little kid. And I try to imagine that, and it doesn't quite feel sufficient. Mm-hmm. And I find that really a heartbreaking exercise, but really illustrative of the distances between us, and also the distance in writing and not speaking your parents' first language.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a several acts of translation, I think, that are happening in the book. There's that obvious, like quite literal translation of trying to understand that memory. There's also translating generationally. There's translating across gender gap, career divides. I think you're uniquely equipped to this because you are a journalist and you have to get like into spaces that are not always for you, or like to find out something, right? Like you are, I'm not sure I would describe you, I don't know, like investigative journalist has like a lot of connotations. That's not what I'm saying. But I think you have, you know, you're incredibly observant and you're curious and you're a great researcher, but there's a level of having to translate your whole life and your whole existence that I think is A, makes you a great journalist, but makes this such a compelling memoir, because you're speaking across every divide that you've ever had to inhabit as a person. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think I try and do that too with the subjects that I'm drawn to. And, you know, there's a little bit of, I don't know if I would describe it as cultural criticism, but I kind of weave in the different contexts in which, like I kind of learned about or thought about Asian American studies, for example, in mm-hmm. one chapter. So yeah, I try to show a wide breadth of things.
Yeah. Yeah. What are I want to talk about some of the different things in this book, because one thing we haven't actually done yet is give a general overview of the book, other than that it's technically a memoir. There's lots of cool stuff in it. It's funny and sad. So I do think, because we have more people tuning in too as we go, because we're live, I'm curious of that. Like, there are so many topics broached in this book, and not just broached, but actually like woven in really seamlessly into this personal narrative that you're telling. That's my favorite kind of like essay or memoir, where it's like, and now for some reason we're talking about like the Big Bopper while we're also talking about an atom bomb, you know, and now we're talking about Asian American studies. Should that be a thing? Is that a thing? And while we're talking about this, and I'm just curious if you want to talk about what is in this book.
Yes.
Can you talk about what's in this book?
I can. Yeah. So the way I talk about it is basically, I really wanted to examine, and I've kind of spoken to this a little bit before in this conversation, but how my family learned to grieve. And after the fallout of my mom's death, I just saw so many ways and parallels between my father and his story of loss. My dad and my mom were immigrants from Hong Kong, and they both lost parents at very young ages. And so much of this book is about their survival and their marriage and what it meant to raise three daughters and try to ensure that, I mean, this seems so common in many immigrant narratives, but ensure that they had a good life. And they had two different ideas of what success seemed like. For my father, I think it was about, you know, financial success or something like that. And my mom, maybe to that degree too, but it felt as though she was always reaching toward something that resembled happiness. Mm. And so woven into those many things is this attempt to answer the question of what do we owe? And within there, it's, you know, a three-generation story, and there's a lot of ghosts that come about, and it's really just this exploration of what it means to observe loss in a family.
Yeah. And we have three generations in the book, which I love, because I really did get a full picture of, first of all, like, in your family, history is the history of 20th century Asian American life, actually. Like, you literally mentioned your grandfather, you're in Cuba, wonder why. Oh, Chinese American Exclusion Act. Like, there is a full history here. I get bothered, shall we say, by the idea that every book written by a person of color has to serve to educate a white audience. And I think your book does not take on that responsibility, nor should it have to, because it is written for the story that you want to tell. It's not trying to do anything. Yeah. But on the other hand, I absolutely learned so much in this book, because you see the way you do when you're reading any really engaging work of nonfiction, because you're like, and that's what these other people are experiencing in life.
Thank you. Yeah, that was a balance that I really wanted to achieve. I mean, because there are certain points of history that people might not know that I think it's worth sharing and spelling out. And then other times, it's sort of like, I can just name check this really quickly, and hopefully if the person doesn't know, maybe they'll be moved to look it up or read a little bit more about it somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that your earlier drafts were a bit of a compulsion, either from your journalistic experience to explain further, or the pressure of, like, potential audience gaze?
That's a really good question. I think I find it hard to answer, because I'm like, oh my God, my earlier drafts were such a mess. It's hard to make the distinction and really pull out what was not working
process.
About them.
Yeah.
I think honestly, the earlier drafts, I didn't have a voice established.
And that's fascinating, because there's such a strong voice in here, Kat. That's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, I think I always kind of had my writer voice, but I didn't know what point of view I was writing from. If I was writing from kind of a child's point of view or an adult looking back. And I think once I got that, which was, I don't know, maybe draft three or four, I don't know, that became a lot easier, and it helped me make a lot more choices and be much more confident about it.
Mm-hmm. And there is, first of all, there's obviously a strong point of view and voice, but also you work in radio, which, if you think about it for 20 seconds, obviously involves a lot of writing, but there's a writing level craft here that is incredibly expressive. And I'm just, you know, curious for you, what was it like to produce something that was not really produced to be spoken, but was to produce to have this intimate relationship with, you don't see the reader on the other end. Like they're not listening. I mean, they might be listening to the audiobook, which is great. And Kat reads it, but it is, you know, that's a very different form of writing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've always been drawn to writing as a means of expression. And I mean, my love for writing, I think, is so inextricable from the way I see grief too, and have just interacted with my mom, because even if I can't speak about her, it's always been possible to sort of write about her ever since high school, You know, like I had a high school English teacher who gave me Annie Dillard, The Writing Life, when I was 13. Yeah, I know. And I still have, it's over there somewhere.
That is one of the best books. That's such a good book.
I mean, at 13, I don't know if I really understood a lot of what Dillard was saying, but I do now. And I think that was really formative, just the, on a sentence level, what her ability is as a writer. But one thing that I do think radio taught me, and being a radio producer and a radio reporter, was being able to, one, do dialogue and capture and play with sort of different formats, where there's a section in the book that is just almost all transcription, which has been really cool. And just kind of being in a scene. If you listen to any or a lot of different radio stories, like my favorite ones are ones that are so narrative, or where you can kind of just pick up on little tiny, you know, hints or winks that just transport you to another place. And I really wanted to also channel that in this book.
Absolutely. There is, there's certainly a play of format. There's a play of time. There's a play of subject. And I do want to talk about play a little bit, because your mom is so playful. She's a prankster. She's literally pranking you, especially like in, and you're playing hide and seek in that, that passage right at the beginning. You know, three kids, new country, being in an incredibly white community. There are parts of the book where you sort of imagine your mom's feelings as you are now an adult woman versus your view of her when you were a kid. I'm just so, so, so incredibly curious, because I think that's a, obviously a part of coming of age, right? Is that we're like, oh, our parents are human beings, right? And like, we have to think about them as humans with their own past and identities and fears and everything. But your mother is such a complete and utter blast. And then there's just these very dark moments that you're reckoning with, or memories that you have. And a lot of the book is kind of stitching together those two ideas into one person.
Because she wasn't just, I mean, she just wasn't one thing. She was, in some cases, probably a little resentful, you know, that she had to be the main breadwinner, that there was so much that she had to sacrifice. And then also she gave so much and pushed so much for us. I mean, some of the things that I didn't include in the ultimate book, or maybe even in different drafts, was I went home to Connecticut, and in our house, we still have so much. You know, my dad does not throw things out, which was almost a blessing as a writer, because it let me pour through these archives. And I found these letters that my mom would write to the public school to try and get my sisters or me in a specific honors class or something like that, or, you know, just be on that track. And you can see the urgency in her voice and in her tone. And there's something about it that's so, I mean, I don't want to say heartbreaking, because I'm going to just keep overusing that word, but that's how it felt reading it.
Yeah. One of my favorite passages, it's so short. It's like towards the end, towards the end of the book, where you're talking about, again, like your mother pulling pranks on you, and it's, mommy, you linger everywhere in this house. So many of your belongings hold memories of you. You always crouch around corners, ready to jump out at us as we pass. You like to stand very still by the coat closet while I use the bathroom next to it. When I emerge, you leap from the shadows. Ah, you shouted. Ah, I scream. I flailed and shrunk from you as you enveloped me in your arms. I catch myself doing this to CJ now. When he is about to walk into the room I am in, I inch to a spot where I think he cannot see me. I hide, not moving my body. And then gleefully, I lodge myself at him and grasp his arms. I got you. I collapse into him in a fit of laughter while he yells, "Cat!" He clutches his chest and catches his breath after I frighten him near the top of his apartment stairs. One of these days, I'm going to accidentally elbow you in the face or something. I got you. I got you. I chant giddily, not wanting to stop. And that's one of those things where I, first of all, laugh imagining you tackling somebody, because it's like a cat launching themselves at somebody, but also you replaying that moment of your childhood. And there's so much of that dichotomy in the book.
Oh my gosh. I do that so much still. And it was so funny, because once, you know, through the pandemic, one of my sisters came and kind of quarantined and stayed with us. And I kind of heard her wake up, but then went out into the kitchen and couldn't find her. And when I turned the corner, she was hiding and she jumped out at me. And it was just, it was so funny because I've just never had another, I've never had another adult do that to me.
Next time I see you, I promise to jump out from you from a dark corner.
That bookstore kind of scares me. And so I would actually probably be a little afraid.
Yeah, there is a different kind of tension when you're in a shopping situation, you're in a store. That bookstores are always haunted, no matter how new or old they are. That's just the rule. They just are, y'all. It's just, you get enough books in a room and there's some stuff going on in there. So, okay, I won't scare you, but, you know, maybe.
You have full permission to, because now that I know that you're game, I will totally do this to you too.
Yeah, absolutely. Definitely. But I do think that that's the thing. It's like we carry all this stuff with us and it's not all bad stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
Joy is just, I mean, it was so important for me to write about that because I didn't want my mom to, in my family, even if this book isn't really just about my mom, it's so much about my dad too and my sisters. And I didn't want us to be sort of memorialized as just our grief.
Yes.
And I just, it was so crucial to include the tinier moments that make up a family.
Yeah. The tiny moments that make a family, the intimate strangeness of every family. Like, families are so weird. We're all just such weird little pocket people, and we have our own little languages and cliques and jokes, and really getting into that. But also, I think I just kept thinking about, like, grief is a prism, and it just, like, reflects out in so many ways. It reflects out in your sense of humor. It reflects out in the language that you use. It reflects in the way that you form relationships with other people. And there is joy in it. There is memory in it. And that's why I said, like, earlier, joy is such a complicated word, because I think we just want it to mean, like, dancing.
Right.
But I think there's shades of, I think joy has, like, a fathomless depth to it.
Yeah. I mean,
the way grief does.
I'm really glad you point that out, because I think as I get older and also as I experience more loss, the way that I see grief now and the way that I see death in particular is, well, one, it's still hard, you know, and it is shattering. It's heartbreaking. Every new loss feels just as though I'd never learned anything from, you know, past points in my life.
Mm-hmm.
But what I've learned, or the way I see grief in my mom right now, is that my relationship with her almost feels dynamic still, in that the memories of her shift with time, where, you know, I mean, if I'm thinking about, like, what it means to potentially have children right now or become a mother, I think of my mom and these anecdotes of her in a different way than I would have at 13 or 21. And
absolutely,
I find that actually really comforting, even if it reminds me of her absence, but it allows me to imagine her in these spaces. And I find that really meaningful.
Yeah, absolutely. I think also there is a true sense of dynamic is a really good word for it, because the book is also dynamic in the way it explores this. But I think we're in a period of national grief. And I did bring that to reading the book. You know, there's really no, we're both on screen right now and we live close together. Clearly something's going on. We're in a period of national grief that we're not processing very well. I mean, whether it's because we are still working or, you know, whatever it is. And I was thinking about the silences and the not talking about it part of grief.
Yeah.
And honestly, this book was a processing experience for me because, you know, I lost my brother 5 years ago. And I was like, I said that the other day, and I was like, no, it was like last year, right? It's that kind of thing where you forget about time, just moves differently after loss. And then also, everything that we use to normalize and stabilize ourselves is sort of topsy turvy right now in our culture, and it's not, like you're saying, it's not a processing book, but it is a dynamic book. It's a dynamic relationship because it's not a point A to point B.
Right. Yeah. Right. It's a point A to just whatever you want it to be. Yeah. I mean, I think there is like a linear progression, but what I wanted to land on was just this level of hopefully growth, but also an openness to how malleable we can be in the face of uncertainty. And I found that really special. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, we have, looks like we've got one last question. I think we've got time for this before we finish up today.
Yes.
How did your journalistic background influence you when you were crafting your memoir, which I think we talked a little bit, but we can speak more directly to.
Yeah.
And congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah. I mean, it definitely helped with my reporting and research and interviewing. Mm-hmm. As a reporter, interview so many people, but I think I'm not usually interviewing my own family about things that where I know there are pressure points or I know the context behind it. And as their daughter or sister, I feel an even deeper obligation to make sure that they're okay. Mm-hmm. And it taught me to be a much more empathetic reporter too. And I think that's something that I will take to profiles that I do in the future or other forms of reporting. But, before I worked on this book, I did a lot of cultural criticism too. And I think that really helped shape my ability and the way I gravitated toward crafting an argument. I think that there are many implicit arguments within this book that are slowly driving toward a point. And I think that was definitely the journalistic background.
Hmm. That's very cool.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sarah, for that question. Thank you everybody for your questions. And I will just say, you all need to read this book. Get it from our amazing library. If you're joining us from another library universe, get it from your amazing library. We do have signed copies at Loyalty Books if you need to purchase one, because Kat is awesome. I do want to quote back your own words to you towards the end of the book. You say, memory is capital. It is love and survival and hope. It is all we have. You wink again to return the gestures. I shut my eyes slow and long. When I open them, you are gone. There's a whole other 2-hour long conversation we should have just about memory and the way memory functions in this book, but it's really, really incredibly beautiful. Thank you for writing this funny and strange and beautifully flawed story. I loved it so much. I really did. Everybody, please pick up Seeing Ghosts. And Kat, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much for your thoughtful questions. And thank you everybody for taking the time.
Thanks, y'all. Happy reading. Still a little bit of summer left. You can still do some summer reading.
And happy birthday, Hannah.
Thanks, y'all.
I like that it appears in the chat multiple times.
Like multiple times. I'm like,